there something I say that sounds conciliative, or is something that you're not agreeing with, to push back on me. So if there's something that you want to challenge, I don't, put your hand up, I'll try and keep this a little more interactive. So if there's something that I say that doesn't make sense, So I want to start with the ideas of what sustainable transport is. So what does this mean to you? What image does this conjure up in your head?
Bikes,
okay, what else? So bikes.
Horses.
Horses? So why are horses sustainable?
Still learning.
They're not using fossil fuels, I guess that's something, sending something in their favor.
Hyperloop.
So Hyperloop, why would a Hyperloop be sustainable?
Because it's built by Superman, and it travels really fast and really far. Well, really far and really fast and really being current.
Or it will be if it's built, but perhaps someday this will be an alternative to the private car. Any other images? Like, what is this that just comes up?
Too much money.
Too much money? What, why too much money?
Hyperloop is expensive.
Okay, the Hyperloop. Okay. So maybe there's cheaper ways to get people out of their cars and create a more sustainable transportation system. And so these are some of the trade-offs, which I'd like to talk about and really build up the ideas of sustainable transportation from these three fundamental constraints which I want to talk about. And then apply these to Santa Cruz and give you my ideas for what we can have to do differently here on campus and in the city as a whole, and hopefully give you some ideas of what you might want to think about in terms of trying to change things, and not just accept the status quo, not just accept what campus and city decision makers have been proposing and telling us, and think a little So the first constraint I want to talk about is space. And in some cities in California, is anyone here from San Jose? Okay, so what does San Jose feel like?
Beautiful.
Beautiful, in what way? Is it dense?
Yeah.
Yeah, in what parts?
I guess like East San Jose.
So maybe some parts of San Jose are pretty dense, like the East Side, absolutely. Stop you from cutting it down. So not anytime soon are we going to expand the width of these streets. So we're really left with what we have right now. That's 28 feet. So why this matters for sustainable transportation is the different modes or different means of transportation, like buses or bikes or cars, take up very different amounts of space. So all you who are sitting here right now, so how much space is this seat taking up, roughly? How many square feet? Look around you, like measure the distance to your neighbors and the front and back. Any guesses?
Six
square feet, so maybe 2 by 3, a little bit more perhaps. But most of you in this part of the room are the people on these buses. So, and this is a bus when you don't even have to stand, you're taking up very little space on the street if you are moving around in this type of seating arrangement on a city bus. Now we have one car driver in this room, right here. No, we have two car drivers. So we're in the seats here, so like, how much space are you taking up?
Probably 6 feet or more.
Right? So the seats here are much further apart. Your average car lane is 12 feet wide. So think of this, 12 feet, and so you can't even stretch out your arms that wide. And then at least 20 feet from one car to another. And so if we put everyone on a bus, we need much less space than if we put everyone in cars. A people like bikes or encourage people to use bikes, that's much less space. So this is the same number of people in a bus, on bikes, and in cars. So in a place like San Jose, this might not matter. There's plenty of space, the streets are wide, expand. In a place like Santa Cruz, the use constraints matter. This is another version of this graphic. The top right image here looks like what people in cars, how much space they take up without the car that's surrounding them. It looks kind of silly, right, with the picture. So this is a real visual image of the different space requirements of different means of getting around. And these are images from Second Avenue in Seattle. So the first constraint we talked about is space. Now the second constraint, someone mentioned in the context of a hyperloop, is money. And we don't live in a world where the money grows on trees, whether it's either the city or the campus has an unlimited budget to spend. So let's look at how much each of these means of transportation costs the public. So bicycle, this is from a Ventura, but he's got a surfboard even. This is pretty much free. Like maybe the city can provide a couple of bike racks for a few hundred dollars, but there's really almost no cost to the campus to accommodate a bike rider or to the city of Santa Cruz to accommodate a bike rider. And for the individuals themselves, and we'll get into talking about equity in a little while, this is one of the lowest cost ways of getting around, only beaten by your own 2 feet. So we could put biking, and we could also put walking in this category of means of transportation free. Buses are somewhat more expensive. On average, one of the Santa Cruz Metro buses that drives around here costs about $185 an hour to operate that bus. And it takes it just under an hour to get from downtown to loop around campus and to go back downtown. It just gave it a little bit less. A lot of that is the labor cost, so providing drivers with a decent standard of living and decent benefit package and sort of living wage, but also the costs of maintaining and fueling the fleet of buses. The routes up to UCSC in Santa Cruz are some of the most efficient in the county, some of the most efficient in California. You probably realize that when you're packed in with like 100 of your closest friends, like you're scrambling to get onto a bus that's leaving Science Hill just after class. So these buses get about 60 trips an hour, which is pretty much the upper limit of what a bus system can do. And so if you divide 185 by 60, you get a cost to provide a trip on a bus of $3 a ride. Of course, some of that is offset by the fares, offset by the fees that you pay in your transit fee, but on average, this is about $3 a ride.
Per person per ride, or for just the bus ride itself? So
like
the bus loaded people?
No, per person per ride. So like on average, like, it costs to get one person to get on a bus and then gets off again, it's $3 for that trip. And so the UCSC routes are actually doing much better on this. In some of the much more lightly used buses in, say, the mountains or in other parts of the county, this could be $10, $12, $15 a ride because the bus costs are the same, but there's many fewer people riding this. So you might think, so this is the average number of people who are boarding university routes. That's from Santa Cruz Metro's last year's budget figure. So on average, a bus that's serving the university, like number 20 or number 16, like every hour that bus is running, there's about 60 boarders. Maybe students, but this is some people that ride these from, say, downtown to the other base as well. And $185 an hour is just the average of all the operating expenses that Santa Cruz Metro incurs divided by the number of hours of service they provide. The campus shuttles are quite a bit cheaper, and if you've like sat underneath a leak in the roof in a campus shuttle, you probably realize why it's quite a bit cheaper. But they're also right. describe much more intensively. Okay, so this sounds like, oh my, $3 a ride, like that doesn't sound like a great deal. But if you compare it to the alternative, then it is a phenomenal deal. Certainly biking and walking are cheaper, but putting people on buses and encouraging people to use a bus system is far more cost effective for a city or a campus than people who park, and this is a core west structure. It turns out to about $18 to build and operate a parking space every day. And so if you pay a few dollars for a parking fee, you're getting a great deal. You're paying a fraction of the cost of that, the cost of campus or the city, if you park downtown, to accommodate your car trip. So how does this $18 a day get built up? Well, let's look at an example from a parking garage which is being proposed right now. So if you've ever been to the farmer's market in downtown Santa Cruz, you know that the city has a proposal to build a parking garage on the, and a library on the farmers market site. 50 to 70,000, you come in at more than $50,000 a space. We want to emphasize that this is not atypical. This is a pretty normal cost for parking in coastal California in a garage. Or as underground parking garage in downtown San Jose, it comes with about $60,000 or $70,000 space. San Francisco, even more. That's just a reflection of the cost of building here, and this doesn't even include the cost of the land. So this is the city's proposal. There's a library here on the ground floor, and most of the site would go to parking. So how do we build up get to this $18 a space? Well, the capital cost, the cost to build this garage, is about $35 million. That's the city's own estimate. And that's for 640 parking spaces. But this is parking spaces there right now. It's a surplus lot. So the number of new spaces is only 514. So if we divide $35 million by 514, we get about $68,000 space. And the city has to pay interest on that, and if they finance it over a 30-year period, it's a typical lifespan in the garage, it turns out to be nearly $4,000 per parking space per year, or about $15 per day just for the building costs. But of course you have to pay to operate this, to clean it, to maintain it, to collect the revenue, $3 a day. So we get a cost of about $18 per day per space for a new parking space in downtown Santa Cruz. There's pretty similar cost structure to what we incur on campus. And now if you think about what people are paying, even the most expensive parking permit, the A parking permits of the faculty and staff, is that $4.70 a day. That the university charges, the city charges, and even less than that if you get a monthly permit, that's $45 a month. So even with a slightly higher campus parking rate, the drivers are getting a great deal. There's a subsidy, extra money that city taxpayers essentially are funding, subsidizing people to drive into downtown Santa Cruz or to drive to campus. And that doesn't even include the value of the land. Land is pretty scarce here on campus. There's not many building sites. And there's a lot of need to find land for new housing. And so the more we give land over to parking, the less we have available for housing. So that's the cost constraint. And the third constraint I wanted to introduce is the environmental constraint. And might have started there because I'm talking about sustainability, but the other two constraints are actually just as powerful. If you walk or bike, you're essentially emitting zero CO2 a mile. Okay, maybe you need to eat a little more, but most of us need to get more exercise. We're not going to go like to eat more just because we're going for a walk that day. So in effect, biking and walking emit 0 pounds of CO2 a mile. A bus is, on average, it's about, this is some national figures, it's a little bit less in Santa Cruz, but just under 2/3 of a pound of carbon dioxide a mile. This is per passenger mile. So every time you get on a bus and you go a mile, you're responsible for about 2/3 of a pound of CO2 a mile. And cars are much more than that, so nearly a pound of CO2 a mile. And that doesn't even account, that's just climate change. There's certainly other externalities or other environmental impacts that driving imposes. Safety, so the thousands of people who are killed and injured, or killed and many tens of thousands more injured on the roads each year is one other of those externalities. And so if we had an environment without limits, if climate change weren't a problem, if air pollution weren't a problem, if the environment had an unlimited capacity to absorb the pollution we dump into the air, then this wouldn't be a problem either. But it's not. As we all know, that climate change is one of the most serious and scary environmental problems that is facing us. So this is another limit, another constraint which a sustainable transportation system needs to respond to. And this is also the transportation is also the area that the city has really failed to do anything meaningful about. So this is an image of the greenhouse gas imagery for the city of Santa Cruz. So we're going from 1990 on the left to 2015 on the right. This is the city's target for 2050. The 2020 target is above. Now the green bar is energy. So this is things like building efficiency, like how much it costs to like heat and cool, how much CO2 to like heat and cool buildings and run them. Thanks to more efficiency, thanks to more solar power, there's been really dramatic reductions in the climate impact of buildings in the city of Santa Cruz. The transportation, that's the red bar. There was a little dip from 1990 to 2005, but for the last 5 years and even further out, there's been almost no change in our transportation emissions in Santa Cruz. So we might pat ourselves on the back for achieving the 2020 target a little early, and the overall direction is in the right, it's going the right way. This is only a good news story in response to energy, to the solar power, to the building efficiency, and so on. From transportation, it's hardly budging. And even as cars have become much more efficient, even as people are driving more electric cars and hybrids, even as car efficiency is improving, we're driving more miles than before, and so extra vehicle travel is outweighing the greater efficiency. So if we're serious about achieving this 2050 target to cut emissions in more than half, we're going to have to do something about the red bar. We can't just rely on putting more solar panels on people's roofs. So far, this is a constraint that we haven't really dealt with. And so, in terms of what is a sustainable transportation system, what I would argue is that a sustainable transportation system is one that prioritizes the modes of the means of transportation at the top of this hierarchy. That put walking first. And second to walking, they put biking first. These are two cheap and zero emission modes. And then put transit first, transit and shuttle, and then maybe ride sharing, people dropping off, and then lastly, car parking. Because as we go up this hierarchy, as we go up from cars towards transit and towards biking and towards walking, we're moving to things that are cheaper, not just for the individual, but also for the city. We're moving to modes that are more space efficient, that make better use of these really limited amounts of land we have to move around. They're more equitable. Walking is accessible to everyone, because, and especially if you, for at least if you include wheelchairs in that walking category. Whereas cars and driving are only available to people who can afford to own and park and operate and maintain a car. So as we move up this hierarchy, we move to a more equitable transportation system as well. And as we move up, we also move to a transportation system that is much less polluting, not just in terms of greenhouse gas, but in terms of air quality and other environmental impacts from transportation. So this is my starting point about what the goal to try and move towards. So how do we get there? Well, those of you who have to your class in the last 40, this may look familiar, so I hope this isn't traumatic to see some of the material in it again. But I would argue that most people make decisions pretty rationally. Most people here on campus, most people in Santa Cruz as a whole. They take decisions based on what's the cheapest way to get there. They make decisions based on what's the fastest way to get where they go. And they make decisions on what is the safest way to get where they're going. Maybe they consider other things like comfort as well. But these are really the three most important determinants of whether people drive, or walk, or bike, or take the bus. So that means that even though people in this room, most of you are probably committed to sustainability, you want to make the effort to make more sustainable decisions in your own lives. Unfortunately, you're in the minority if that's the case. For most people, just saying that, oh, please drive, please don't drive, please take the bus is a bad air pollution day. This is a sign of the Bay Bridge, the old Bay Bridge in San Francisco. These have very minimal effects. Just telling people that please ride the bus or please bike, it's better for the environment, is the impact can be measured as a fraction of a percent, especially over the long run. Even when you can see how bad the air quality is, it's a very minimal change that people make in response to these types of public information programs. So if we look at places where most people bike or take the bus or walk, particularly cities like Copenhagen and London and other places in Europe and Japan, places like Tokyo, Japanese people aren't somehow more altruistic and thinking about the environment. Dutch people or Danish people aren't more necessarily taking all their decisions because biking is better for the environment. No, they're taking these decisions because those cities have made taking transit or biking or walking the cheapest way to get around. They made it the fastest way to get around, and they made it a much safer way to get around. So if we want to move to a more sustainable transportation system in a place like Santa Cruz, I'd say we have to make biking and walking and taking the bus cheaper and faster and safer than driving. And that's a way to bring about much more dramatic and radical changes to transportation systems. So what do we do? I'd say that we make buses, walking and cycling faster and cheaper than driving. This is a bus rapid transit system in Mexico City, where they took a lane for the buses, they're insulated from the traffic, it's much faster than driving, and then these buses arrive like perhaps every 45 seconds, and they're all packed. And it's become a victim of its own success. Secondly, we need to address safety concerns, particularly for bikers. Santa Cruz is one of the highest rates of pedestrian and cyclist injuries and fatalities in the state of California. And we need to make sure that drivers pay the full cost of driving. So that $18 a day that I told you it costs for parking, why is everyone else subsidizing people's decisions to drive? Maybe it should be doing the opposite, but at least as a first step, making sure that drivers pay the full cost of providing them with parking space. So this is the overall framework for some of the specific suggestions that I want to make to you in the next 20 minutes or so. course you do, but if you don't, then please do chime in. Please do chime in with your opinions, and we'll certainly have some time for the discussion and questions at the end. So number one, anyone recognize history here? Where is that? So the number 10 bus going, turning, just turned red and high. Anyone been stuck on that bus? Your bike? Would you ever come? Okay, so is there something we've nodded? How long do you spend on this bus when there's a lot of traffic on High Street?
30 minutes.
30 minutes just to get down that bit of high? So if it's the same amount of time to be stuck in this traffic jam in a car versus on the number 10 bus, then maybe it's not surprising that people drive, at least have a little more space. You're kind of like crushed in into someone's armpit on this on the number 10, and you can go directly where you're going as opposed to having to go to the route of the number 10 is following. So if we want to make the buses here a more attractive option, we have to get them out of congestion. We have to make it faster to travel by bus than one of these cars which is blocking this bus's way, especially considering there could be 50 people on this bus who are being obstructed by 15 or 20 drivers. That doesn't sound like a fair division of this limited road space to me. So what do we do? Bus lanes. In this case, we need to remove the parking lane at least a few times, but there's certainly space on Story Street to have a dedicated lane for the number 10 to get it out of this traffic, at least when it turns the corner from High Street. But it needs that political courage to tell the people who like to park their cars and use city streets as free parking, free storage for their two-ton lump of metal, that they need to put their two-ton lump of metal somewhere else. And rather than getting in the way of the hundreds of people who are trying to get the number 10 down the street. So this is perhaps the most visible example, but another example is priority at traffic signals. If you've been on the number 16 at Mission Street, and you're coming up Laurel, and your bus just misses the light, and you have to sit there for another 3 minutes, that's the type of problem that can easily be addressed by traffic signal priority. Many other cities do it. Los Angeles has a great system of traffic signal priority. Europe is doing this for 30 years. The technology is there. It just needs a small amount of money and a lot of political will to give these buses the priority. And thirdly, restrict car access to central campus. This is an example of the bus lanes that have been implemented in places like San Francisco, giving buses the red carpet treatment to get them out of traffic. So restricting car access to central campus, it makes no sense to me why you can drive past the bookstore why you have a right as a driver to get in front and obstruct the buses that could be carrying 50 or 60 or 70 people, even more on the bendy buses, the articulated buses. Why does the university allow that? Probably I'll get to this in a minute, probably because most of the senior administrators who make these decisions aren't the ones on the buses, they're the ones who are driving. So restricting car access to central campus, pretty simple, just have a do not enter except buses and emergency vehicles. If you want to drive up to College 910, there's another route that goes there. It's called Coolidge and goes skirts around the edge. You don't need to have cars driving through the most congested part of the university campus. And then the related part of that is trying to remove cars from central campus as much as possible. Again, there's a loop bus here, two loop buses, that are stuck carrying up to 50 people or 60 people each, that are stuck behind a row of cars, mostly with one person in each of these. That's partly because of the long-standing campus policy to build more parking in central campus. College 910 came with a huge amount of new parking. just encouraging, providing a reason for people to drive up to campus. And there's limited amount of road space here. We can't drive right on roads. The only way to speed up traffic here is to get the cars out of the way and to encourage them, or force them to park more remotely. The simpler way is to encourage all door boarding. So this is a pretty typical photo. If you're trying to get over, this is a number 16 at College 910. A line of 20 people there trying to get on the bus. Everyone who gets on the bus has to file through the front door. It's B. 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 And then the driver yells at you to like move to the back, please, to make space for people getting on the bus. When there's a perfectly good door on the back, which no one is allowed to use except to get on. And so a really simple way to speed up buses is to allow all door boarding, at least on the campus stops. That more than 95% of people getting on buses on campus already have a student ID or a monthly pass. So the $2 or so a trip that a metro would lose would be far outweighed by the speed improvement of getting buses boarding more quickly. And remember, we're paying $185 an hour for this bus to sit there at a stop while everyone files on through this front door and shows their pass to the driver. This isn't a new policy. This is something that San Francisco did several years ago. They reduced the time, the dwell time, or the amount of time that the bus has stopped stops to let people on by nearly 40%. So this is perhaps the most quickest and most dramatic improvement to bus speeds that we could make, a very simple change. And it allows more frequent service for exactly the same cost. And rather than paying the metro $185 an hour for this bus to sit here at a stop, that money can be spent by doing another loop up to campus and providing more capacity and more frequency on the campus. So the third policy that I wanted to suggest is about protected bike lanes. Now this is a picture that right outside CVS in downtown. So if you're coming over the bridge, CVS is here on your right. New Leaf is kind of in front of you and to your left. So this looks, if you're on a bike, this kind of looks like a bike lane. Right? At least to me, it looks like a bike lane. Certainly, you don't want to be riding like in the car lane. Unfortunately, this But you can see at the top of that bike lane, if you're not paying attention, you ride straight into this post with a traffic signal on. So the city of Santa Cruz has made some good changes in terms of the bike system. There are so many places where the bike lanes are unsafe, patently inadequate. They get away with it, like saying this isn't a bike lane, this is a gap between two traffic lanes. It looks like a bike lane to me. And more importantly, as a biker, you're exposed on both sides. You have cars coming past on your right, you have cars coming past on your left, and the only protection you have is a white van. Maybe many of you are comfortable with it. Okay? Semi-comfortable with it. But if we want to encourage more people to take up cycling and get more people on their bikes, we need to build a bike system that is catering to more than this courageous or foolhardy minority of people that is comfortable riding a bicycle with cars whizzing past on both sides. We need to design for 8-year-olds. We need to design for 80-year-olds and more than 80-year-olds. We need to design for people with all levels of riding skill and confidence rather than just this courageous group. So this is the not a bike lane coming on Soquel into downtown. The city is making some improvements, so green lanes, green paint, at least you can see where you're meant to be at a bicycle, and you can, the drivers perhaps pay attention to where you're meant to be on a bicycle, but it's still no protection. Especially the cars that are turning right, and they just not paying attention, or they're texting, or they've had a drink, or they're talking to their passenger. Just a bit of repaint is not doing a whole lot to protect you. It's not doing a whole lot to get an 8-year-old parents comfortable with an 8-year-old driving their bicycle. If you're a 75-year-old, you're 80-year-old, and you have some more confidence, but it's unlikely that many people will look at this and say, yeah, I feel safe now, I'm going to take up a biking. Whereas other cities have solved this problem. Santa Cruz doesn't need to reinvent the wheel. This is in Cambridge, Massachusetts, Cambridge. Bikes here are protected by the row of parked cars. That's why you can even ride 2x2 and have a conversation with someone on a bicycle. There's a nice buffer there. So even if someone opens their car door without looking, they're not going to wipe you out on a bicycle. This is a type of safe, protective bike lane network that the city has so far not shown much interest in, beyond a few small examples like High Street and on Beach Street, and the campus side of that. There's plenty of space on Hagar to provide protective bike lanes, but there's no signal that the campus is doing this. There's no bike infrastructure like this. This is another college town, this is Burlington and Vermont. Again, not just protection, but also the ability to turn biking into a safer social option. And Santa Cruz sometimes likes to compete with UC Davis. Well, in terms of biking, Davis is winning the battle, like hands down. This is a city. This is a new intersection that the city of Davis just opened that provides full protection from cars that are turning. The bike lane doesn't end at the intersection and expect the bike to magically disappear and then reappear the other side of the intersection. No, they recognize if you're riding, you actually want to get through the intersection as well, and then providing a safe way for you to do this with some curbs that are protecting you and making you visible to turning cars. And this is a type of street where it's very feasible to implement this system. This is a student project last quarter, Jesus Contreras and Shirley Chan, who did my seminar last quarter. They showed that on Water Street, so this is just as you're turning from Ocean, there's a chase down in the corner of the county offices on the corner. Right now, there's meant to be a bike lane here, but it's not the most safe or comfortable place to bike. They show that there's plenty of space to add a bike lane with protection, whether with posts or with buffers, and the only thing you have to do is have the political courage to tell the garden supply store that they're losing their two parking spaces right outside their shop. And instead, in Santa Cruz, the city has given in too many cases to the demands of car owners, to the demands of people who want to park right outside their house on this street, which is owned by all of us, which is a public resource. This is a bike lane on Bay Street. Apparently, people don't need to park to bike on Bay Street after 6 p.m., Monday to Friday. If you're biking down this bit of Bay Street at 6:02 p.m., boom, tough. Like this could be cars parked in. You have to cycle in the middle of the street. On weekends, the bike lane disappears. Apparently, bike safety isn't an issue on this part of Bay Street on Saturdays and Sundays, let alone at night. So classes obviously go well later than 6 p.m. But the city has chosen to prioritize the needs of people to store this lump of metal on the street, as opposed to trying to encourage more people into sustainable modes. So the overall approach of the university and the city is really to provide bike infrastructure. Some of it's not bad. Some of it like has some nice green paint or like nicely new striped white lines. None of these are bad, but rather they're not the radical change that we need to move towards a more sustainable transportation system. The approach, or at least the implicit philosophy, has been, well, if there's some space left over, we can give this to bikes. If we don't need the space for parking, we can give it to bikes. Buses, you know, they don't need cars, they can just like stay in the regular traffic flow, we're not going to give them any sort of priority. And there's been this reluctance to stand up to the residents who would be inconvenienced. They have to like walk half a block to park on a side street. Or people who are driving around might have to wait an extra light cycle at the intersection because a lane has been removed to give priority to buses or to bikes. So even though they don't say this explicitly, they don't write this down in any policy, this is the actions that cars take priority, parking may not be removed, and cyclists, pedestrians, and bus riders tend to be second class citizens. And this is Westcliff Drive. This is the place where tourists from like, all over the region come and like to spend an afternoon walking or biking, taking their dogs. This is even in last weekend. It's another warmest weekend. This is at the height of the summer season. You can see just how many people are using this combined sidewalk and bike lane on Westcliff Drive. And so you can see that the cars here get 28 feet of space. The bikes and the dog walkers and the pedestrians and the people who are just kind of hanging out and wanting to lean over the railing, skateboarders, the people who just want to like watch the surfers, they get 10 feet. So here, even in April, this isn't a warm day, this isn't the height of the summer season, of 12 people using 10 feet of space, 4 cars using the 28 feet of space. And this is the way that the city has made decisions about how to allocate this resource, which you saw at the start, is very limited in nature. So the fourth idea which I wanted to propose to you is about stopping subsidizing parking, stopping using campus resources or city resources to give away land or money to encourage people to drive their cars to campus. We saw $18 a space per day. That's the marginal cost. That's the cost of adding a space to campus. And that isn't even including the value of the land. But another parking permit. If you have a monthly permit, $2.25 a day if you drive every day. If you use a daily scratcher, it's $5 a day. And so it's not just we're subsidizing people, we're also the university is saying, well, we want you to drive more. You get a discount if you drive more. It's like the all-you-can-eat parking buffet that you pay one flat fee for and then please drive as much as you want. Rather, there's no incentive here to like, well, maybe you have can take the bus occasionally, or it's a nice day, you might be able to bike or take a longer walk. There's a built incentive not to do that. And the way that the university has structured its parking fees, and the way that it's actually made this difference, this gap between the all-you-can-eat buffet of monthly parking permits and the daily scratcher price, that gap has been widening over time. Now it's a 53% discount you get if you say, yeah, I'm a driver, I want to drive every day and park in the remote. And it's a very similar gap in terms of the A parking permits as well. And so one question that always comes up as well, there's many people are about low incomes, particularly students, but also many of the workers, the employees here that keep their campus running, whether it's dining hall workers or custodial staff. Well, the good news is that there's already a precedent for this. But certainly as an employee of UCSC, I pay a different amount for my health, I pay an amount for my health insurance benefits that's based on my income. And the lowest paid employees at UCSC pay much less than their health insurance. It's the same health insurance plan. The higher, the more you earn, the more you pay a month for health insurance. So why don't we do the same for parking? That if you are a really high-paid administrator or a professor, then sure, like, increase the cost of parking for them and perhaps keep it at a lower rate for the lowest paid employees, and perhaps increase the differential between the A and B permits, which allow you to park in central campus where the impacts of parking are most acute, where you're delaying buses, where the space is more limited, and create a big gap between the remote parking and the central campus. It also shows the campus priorities, how much housing fees have increased over the years compared to parking fees. And this is the increases since 2006. So if you live on campus, you probably see like every year the university asks you to pay more for your room and for your meal plan, at the same time as taking away lounges and reducing the actual quality of that housing. So if we're starting in 2006 and 7, on-campus housing prices have gone up by nearly 40%. The parking permits haven't seen anywhere close to the same amount of increase. The university has done its best to keep parking as affordable as possible to benefit that minority of people who want to drive, minority of higher income people for that matter, who want to drive and park their car on campus. For 10 years it was flat, and only recently it started to go up a little bit, and there's only about a 13% increase over this time period. Housing prices have gone up about 3 times as much as parking prices. And if you look at this in terms of inflation adjustment, but even after accounting for inflation, that's the dotted line, housing costs, this is room and meal plan, and the amount of the university advertises in its bulletin, it's still gone up even after inflation, whereas parking has actually become cheaper since over the last 10 years or so. It's cost less to park now on campus than it did in 2006 after adjusting for inflation. And so we're really moving in the wrong direction here. Like if we want a more sustainable transportation system that is charging drivers the full cost of their decisions, we're not moving towards that, we're going in the opposite direction. So we actually have rent control in Santa Cruz. Many of you, I think, were involved in the campaign or saw it, bring rent control to Santa Cruz in the fall. We actually have rent control. But we don't have rent control for housing, it seems that we have rent control for parking here in Santa Cruz, but our cars get to have a very predictable and stabilized rent, and the Chancellor has to improve every parking increase, it has to go through the whole consultation process, but if housing prices are going to increase, then apparently it's not such a big deal. And we see it here in the differential on-campus housing, going up to 39%, parking permit up by just 14%. So the last idea I want to suggest to you, is to eliminate what is called parking requirements. And what is a parking requirement? Well, this is a law that the common with most cities in the United States. The city of Santa Cruz says if you want to build new housing, if you want to build a new shop for that matter, if you want to build a new apartment building, you have to build a certain amount of parking along with that housing. It's between 1 and 2 parking spaces per apartment or per house. And this applies to pretty much every housing unit in such a housing development in Santa Cruz. So go to next thing to the bus station in Santa Cruz. This is the most transit accessible site in the whole city. It's right next to Metro Center. There's buses to campus, there's buses to San Jose, there's buses to Monterey, there's buses to Watsonville. So this is going up right next to the most transit accessible place in Santa Cruz, on the site of the Taco Bell, on Laurel and Pacific. 205 apartments, with more than one parking space per apartment. 252 parking spaces for 205 apartments. This was approved by City Council a few months ago in December. So what this says to you, if you want to move to Santa Cruz and you can't afford a car, or you don't want to own a car, and you want to make use of a bus system and biking, this housing is not for you. You're going to be forced to pay for a parking space whether or not you want one. so even though I'll show you some figures in a moment about how much of this parking actually goes to waste, this is a cost that everyone pays. That your rent is higher if you live in a development like this, if you have to buy a condo, the purchase price is much higher. This empty parking space is costing the developer more than 50. We have a housing crisis, we have people living in the River Street camp, we have people sleeping in their cars, but at least we have a place for those cars to park. These are the policy priorities that the city has set out through these minimum parking requirements. Even the university, so that was the city, the university is also buying into this car-oriented logic, at least for the families. So the family student housing, which the university is pushing at the entrance to the Hagar Meadow site, this is one of the lowest density parts of campus, so the proposals for campus. There's more of this land is actually going to roads and parking than to the actual housing. More of the site is going to be paved over for parking spaces and access roads than it is to family student housing, which you probably call it family student parking. And more than one parking space per unit is in the plans for by the university, who were just approved by the regions. So again, if you are a student with kids and you want to live in this and you don't want a car, you say, hey, I can't afford to have a car, or I don't want to bring a car to Santa Cruz, the university says, sorry, like you're going to have one whether you like it or not, it's going to be built, factored into the cost of your housing. These are the requirements of Santa Cruz. I'll skim over them, but just to say, if you look at the top line, if you have a one-bedroom apartment, you need to provide one parking space. If you have a one-bedroom unit in a duplex or a triplex, you need to provide 1.5 parking spaces, even for a one-bedroom apartment. And if you have two bedrooms, you need to build two parking spaces on site. Again, without regard to where it is, whether it's in transit, or whether it's in a car-oriented sprawl, or whether the residents want or can afford to provide a car. We see that many people in Santa Cruz don't have a car. Among renters, 14% of people could choose not to have a car, and almost half of the other renters only have one car. So this is a minority that we're not catering to. A lot of these people who have the lowest income in the city, but also it's encouraging people to own a car. If you give them a parking space for free, they're like, well, why don't I have a car? Why don't I bring a car to campus, even if I'm kind of on the fence and I don't think I will use it that much. And in some parts of the city, and these are some maps that students in my class a couple of years ago put together, the yellow areas, which are downtown here, and also in Beach Flats, and also in part of the east side. The yellow places are even up to a third of rented households do not have a car. These are the people who have been ignored in the current city planning decisions, which are implicitly making us all pay for parking, whether we want it or not. We're also building a lot of parking which is going to waste. These are the same students. These are surveys they did overnight at peak parking times at some of the apartment complexes in Santa Cruz, even ones that aren't well served by transit. So Pacific Shores, down by the coastal campus, right on the edge. Cypress Point and then Chestnut Townhomes close to downtown. The height of this bar is the number of parking spaces. Then on different nights, these are the number that are occupied. So you can see that there's almost as many empty parking spaces. These aren't any cheaper because they're empty. It's still costing $50,000 of space these apartment developments in the city of Santa Cruz. So again, with the city planning laws and the university's policies, really promoting a vision which is in contrast to what many people are actually reflecting that they want, which is the opportunity to live without a car or living in one car rather than two. So Santa Cruz is California's least affordable city, measured by rents in relation to incomes. And so parking matters, these minimum parking requirements matter, because not just it takes up land, which can be used for more housing. If you pay the land for a parking lot, that's less land that is available for the housing. But also because these costs are bundled in, they're factored into a rent or a sales price. Even on the US as a whole, $142 a month that the average renter is paying for parking. And then the charts we show that especially underground spaces, this is going up to $1,800 a month. So the idea here is that if we have affordability by law, if we have affordable housing policies that try and regulate, say, that a certain number of units in new buildings have to be sold or rented at below market rates, this has limited scope. It's only going to reach a small fraction of the population. But if we try and build housing that is more affordable, particularly affordable housing that is affordable because it has doesn't come with a parking space. And so if you want to have your Tesla and you want to drive over the hill to Silicon Valley, but maybe you'll look elsewhere for another type of housing. So this type of affordable housing by design is going to reach many more people than trying to mandate So in summary, so just a few words to sum up, and then I'd love to hear some of your reactions and questions. So these are the five pretty straightforward proposals which I think the city and the university should consider. Get buses out of congestion, make them competitive in speed to the private car. Speed them up through a land to board, based on campus, through any door. Addressing the safety challenge by having a network of protected bike lanes that allow kids, allow older people, allow them not courageous to bike. Stop subsidizing driving, charging drivers at full cost, which is also a way to create revenue to invest in transit and invest in biking. And then eliminate the law that means that developers have to provide parking, whether or not they want it, and whether or not their residents want it. And so looking back to the ideas at the start, it's not just the environment that has limited capacity to absorb our pollution. It's also space that's limited. It's also money that's limited. And so these are five concrete ways that we can prioritize the nodes that take up less space and take up less money. So why are we doing it? Well, partly it's because the people who are making these decisions, both at the very senior levels of the city, and here on campus. So there's some people who are doing a great, great job, trying their best to make changes. But many people at the top have this, they're looking at things through their windshield or in their rear view mirror here. They're driving. And this creates, not surprisingly, an implicit bias. If you drive to a campus every day, the problems you see are the problems that face drivers. If you don't get on a number 16 at Science Hill just after classes come out, you don't know what it's like to wait for two or three buses to go by before you can cram your way onto one. You don't know what it's like to be 20 minutes late for class because the bus didn't come or the bus was too full to let you on. So there's much less awareness of these decision makers of the challenges that are facing bus drivers and pedestrians. This is a picture of actually, if you have the slug route app on your phone, it tells you where the loop buses are coming. I was waiting for a bus at 8:40 a.m. a couple of weeks ago, and I took a screenshot because the only two loops that are running are in the TAPS yard. There wasn't a single bus at this